generously come to join us this evening. You may have recognized Samantha from the film. Samantha is co-founder of the BC Tiny House Collective, which is a community organization working to legalize and legitimize tiny houses and tiny living across BC. She also works as a community animator, a networker, and facilitator for the Farm to School Vancouver Area Regional Hub and Vancouver West Side Area. She has been a coordinator for Metro Vancouver's homeless camp as well. So we're very happy to have her with Charles this evening. Both Charles and Samantha, I wonder if you could get us started with just any comments you may want to begin with this evening, some background to the film or your own background in the area of housing as well.
What's up? Can you hear me? It's turned on. I think it could be a bit louder though. Bit more? How's that? Okay, I'll try to speak up. But first, thanks for staying. Feels horrible when people walk out. I want to introduce two people who are in the film as well. My dear, dear friend, Sabrina Jones, just right over here, and her son, Trevor. Sam, you've been doing a bunch of work with the Tiny Homes Collective and trying to get the governments to allow tiny homes to exist, because for those of you who don't know, tiny homes aren't allowed to, you know, be set up anywhere, and that's something that Sam's been really, really active in, to try and change the policies so that we can have tiny homes. What's up?
I think we need to live allowed.
Do you have formal aid? Yeah, that's really low. Test. That sounds kind of dead now. Test. If we just talk really loud, is that okay? So, could you tell us like what your experience has been? Like, is it going to happen? Are we going to allow tiny homes?
Well, tiny houses are technically illegal in most municipalities across BC. And what I've been doing is working with city staff, council, builders, all the different stakeholders who are involved in the housing process, to try and identify the challenges and the opportunities to legalize tiny homes.
Now it's on.
There we go.
And I think that it's just a matter of time, and that's basically due to the city kind of opening their eyes that there's a massive problem. And that there's people already living in RVs, there's people already living in vans, as we saw in the film. There's people already living in tiny houses across the province, and if they don't regulate them, then there are going to be major issues. So I think it's just a matter of when, not if, but it's probably going to be a couple of years to sort out those logistical challenges. Yeah.
My sense of it, I wonder if this is yours as well, that is this helping?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
So we can use some more volume, though.
Okay, or I could just do sort of a Ray Charles thing here. My sense of it is that part of the reason, maybe the whole reason that these things don't move quicker is because the people who have the power to make the changes aren't living in tiny homes and they're not living on the street.
Yeah, I think that's a big part of it, is that they're not directly impacted. I know that's been one of my main motivations, is having a house and not having anywhere to put it has been a real push for me to get something done. But I also know that there are some real challenges there, especially in terms of things like sanitation, because tiny homes often use alternative waste management practices like compost toilets and solar, and there's like there's real public health issues that people are genuinely worried about, but it doesn't mean that the solution doesn't already exist. It's just fear of implementing something weird or alternative.
How about you guys? Does anybody have a question or an observation that you want to share with us? Yes, ma'am.
Links with an observation that I made during this. Every time I see it, I learn something new. And what's happening is that we're kind of scrambling right now. So there's a lot of will, as you mentioned. There's a lot of people who are working on the ground and really want to see these things happen. But for instance, the reason I wanted to live in a tiny house was so I could get my foot in the door so that I could do some of the bigger work that needs to happen around inequity. Because the root of the problem is not our zoning bylaws. You know, it's something so much deeper than that, and we need a lot of manpower to be working on that, woman power to be working on that. But we can't, because we can't afford to live in the city. So right now we're just kind of like just scrambling to get our footing before we can work on those bigger issues, which is a real tragedy, I think.
Yes.
Charles, thanks for the movie, first of all. It's told a story that hasn't been told that way. And maybe you can mention sometime where people can see this, whether it's online or whether there's other places and times to present. I think right now it's really valuable that if there's much will for small houses or alternative, your film, I think, really answered that there's like money will that's pushing like the wave against that.
Yeah.
And I was born here, and you've given a great like perspective, like walking back through time, including habitat, and including looking at that south side of Falls Creek. I was at Sunday's gathering where Judy Page was speaking as well, and that, you know, it's not just your story in the art. So like money flowing as pushing the gates, that idea, because you're like toppling that investment. You know, so that's why there's such a big pushback. That if that is what happens, all that investment like floods away. And it made it really clear with Bachman. Like I look at the city, why are the towers going up that's called green when you're knocking down all the small buildings? So you know, vision has no vision. And Bob Rennie really reiterated that. So thanks for that part. And you know, let us know where we can let other people see this, whether it's online or.
Well, thanks for your comments. I really appreciate that. The film will be streamable for free on Knowledge Network. Just go to knowledge.ca and type in Vancouver, and it'll be the first thing that comes up. The broadcast premiere is on the 17th. As the finale for their globalization series.
October 17th?
Yep. But anybody in Canada, it's geoblocked for anywhere else, but anyone in Canada will be able to watch it free.
Well, I'll mention that's like a celebration when you're able to have it broadcast on that wide way.
Yeah.
So even if there's follow-up streaming, I know I've had broadcast parties when there's been that acknowledgement of that story being broadcast. Not everyone has access online, so broadcast makes a difference.
Very much so, and they have been broadcast over a bunch of times. Sorry?
I should.
Oh, Trevor, stop that.
I should also mention that the BC Tiny House Collective is having a fundraiser. We can talk about this.
With
a screening, hopefully, later in November. So keep your eyes open for that.
Charles, if you know what time, let us know what time so we can tell you.
I don't. It's like prime time, 7 o'clock, something like that. But just go to knowledge.ca and it's all there.
Okay,
yeah. Or it's in your TV listings as well. Yeah. But you know, I do want to address a little bit, you know, the sort of elephant in the room. That one of the guys in the film, Fayez Ali Mohammed, the economist, who spoke so intelligently about, you know, the world economy and stuff, he talks about the historical precedents for what we're going through right now. And he reminds us, and I think we need reminding, that the strong middle class that we've been experiencing since the end of the war is not the normal. That's an anomaly. What's been the normal in human civilization has been a few people with everything and everybody else being a serf, right? And the miracle of the creation of a middle class is such a recent phenomenon, but we're heading back in the other direction. And we don't have to. We can fight against this. And we see that when we do fight, there have been some remarkable successes. The thing that drives me nuts about this is when there's a demonstration, like Russ said in the film, when there's a demonstration, we tend to be pretty complacent. We don't show up. You know, you get 60,000 people going to a football game, a hockey game, and you get 100 people going to a housing rally. The housing rallies make a really big difference. When our politicians see that we're not going to vote for them unless they do something different, they will change. I mean, you look at how the Energy East project was just canceled. Do you know how many demonstrations there were against Energy East? That clearly factored into that. So, you know, the same thing with the Northern Gateway. We went to all those demonstrations. Do you think, honestly, that the NDP government or new government would have launched a proper investigation into the Site C, the dam that they're trying to build in our beautiful peace country, if we hadn't gone to all those demonstrations? We were standing out there, 12 people in the rain, but it makes a difference. So I implore you, if you believe in this stuff, go, because it makes a big difference. Yes, sir.
Me? Yeah?
No, there's somebody behind you.
I did
have an option. I didn't think you were
in. I wanted to speak, yeah, okay.
This is a different issue, but very closely related, is addiction housing, alcoholism, and all that kind of stuff. And I've been through it, and I've been through the difficulties getting back into the normal stream of activity. And housing, of course, is one of them. And Vancouver is one of the worst places to be that. And I don't think we have any expertise in the area, but just wanted to know, get a comment on it.
No, it's not something that I have any expertise in at all. One thing I do know, though, because it's been a subject that we've studied and researched a lot, is that our drug policies here have been an utter absolute failure. And in places like Portugal, where they've decriminalized virtually everything, it's also spilled over into the alcohol abuse area as well, where they've found that it's much more economical, rather than putting people in prison, to create employment opportunities for people. It's subsidized the jobs for a few years, and it's just created this this wonderful situation where people are going back to work, they're starting to feel proud of themselves. Like Seth Klein said in the film, we spend double in BC on chasing the homeless problem and addiction problems than we could spend on a reasonable poverty reduction program. So, like you said, we make some crazy decisions. That's something we can fix.
Yeah. I've been clean and sober for a while.
And congratulations.
Job again.
Good on you, man.
But housing is a problem.
Yeah. Yeah. You had a question.
So I did have an observation.
Thank you.
So you were talking to the mayor, Robert Sennett. He's talking about his legislation, et cetera, et cetera. And I'm just wondering why, and you also talked about protests, why for, I think, 10 years, they did not enforce with the Sahodas, that they let those people live in SROs in Canada without running water, without toilets. And this is Vancouver. This is Canada. This is not a small home. And this is Gregor Robertson saying he's going to enforce something. He's not enforcing anything. That is my observation. I think that's one reason when you say, why don't people get out and protest? Well, the government is not there. He's absolutely not there. And my other comment was with respect to the Chinese woman in West Vancouver and saying that, oh yes, we're trying to assimilate. Well, if you knew what was happening in Richmond and people who bought condos and stratas, and the meetings were all held in Cantonese and Mandarin, and they ended up having to leave, and that was okay. They went to human rights said that's fine. So, I mean, that wasn't very balanced as far as I was concerned, so I would like you to kind of address those. Did you not see those things, or did you just not want to include them?
No, we saw those things. First things first, you know, my dad used to say, no matter who you vote for, the government always gets in. You know, I think that Sandy Garasino answered the question really perfectly when she said, who are the biggest contributors to civic government? You know, money talks and bullshit walks, if you'll excuse my French.
That's right.
And I mean, Gregor seems like a really nice guy, and he speaks beautifully. He's just such an inspiring speaker. But he swims in the same water that the Sahodas and the Boses and all of those guys, and Bob Rennie and all those guys swim in. And it's, they have their own set of rules, you know? I mean, notwithstanding that, demonstrations do matter, they do help. It's just that it's frustrating, and I know that it is. I've been frustrated. The sightseeing thing is one, because we've made a movie about the place, and I have so many friends up there now. We've been so frustrated at how little response the government gives, no matter how much we demonstrate, but it's just incremental. It's just like, we're so irritating to them that sooner or later something will happen, and then you just chip away at it. But I mean, they've got, you know, 24/7 lawyers.
No, but I'm talking about there were fines. There were bylaw violations.
Sure.
Why were they not enforced? Because the city did not, if I was violating the bylaw, it would be enforced. Anyone else would have enforced, but the Sahodas did not for some reason. And that is absolutely wrong. That is what should be investigated. And that's where we have to start.
Yeah, no, I don't disagree with you at all. With respect to your second point about the Asian woman who's in the film, I'm not sure that everyone gets the irony of that comment that you quoted, because I find the irony in that so thick that you could cut it with a knife when she says, us rich Asians are just trying to fit in with the culture here. They're doing a really good job of it. They're fitting in fine. The culture here is that if you're rich, you buy a Maserati, and you buy a big house with a swimming pool and all that. So she's fitting in just perfectly. I mean, again, Pei is an extremely nice person, and she's moral and really thoughtful and so on. But the rules, a very good friend of ours who's surprisingly a venture capitalist, he has a really interesting perspective on it. He said that if you have rules and if you enforce them, as you so intelligently pointed out, if you have rules and you enforce them, people will follow them because nobody wants to go to jail. Rich guys don't want to go to jail, so if you've got rules and you enforce them, people will follow those rules. The problem is in many cases we don't have the rules, and then when we do, we don't enforce them. So how do we do that? Guys like Sam Cooper, people like Sandy Garasino, who really speak truth to power, those guys are my heroes. Because you know their road is not an easy road. They get threats all the time. They don't get paid very well, but they do what they do with their investigative reporting because they believe in it. You know. So I don't know, I wish I could say something more hopeful.
So, just to follow on your point of enforcing rules, and then people will fit in those rules. It's the second time I've seen your film, and I have some cognitive dissonance, and I'm trying to realize how to answer myself, and it's language. When you talk about a tiny house, it's a house. Mm-hmm. It's a house. Mm-hmm. When you talk about the vacancy rate being near zero, and then we have the numbers not in the film, but 45,000 empty units within Vancouver proper, then our vacancy rate is 23%. So the language that's missing is from the 60s and 70s of the United States. We are redlining, and instead of based on race, it is income, class, inequality. So the language, the vocabulary to articulate why the rules need to be enforced is missing.
That's a huge point. That and, I mean, our policies and our language are dictated by our culture. And I think the root of all of these problems is our culture. We call it a tiny house because there is no policy for a house on wheels, and so it doesn't conform to any other type of housing stock. But it is a house, it's a home, actually. And what we need, at the risk of sounding dramatic, is a cultural revolution. That's what's gonna solve these problems. But that's a long time coming. You're right.
Actually, Sam, if I could just pick up on what you're saying. Yeah, it's a long time coming. We do get frustrated, but I think we, because our lives are so short, there's 4 score, 7 years or whatever it is that we live, we don't realize how quickly things have changed and how quickly things do change. I mean, when you think about climate change, all of us are pretty frustrated about the slow pace, and you see the developments down south and so on. But realistically, we've only been talking about climate change for, you know, 30 or 40 years. And when you think about, you know, Volvo announcing that they're not going to build internal combustion motors after 2019, that's amazing. When you see, you know, Elon Musk offering Puerto Rico to rebuild their entire power grid with sustainable solar energy, in the space of time we've been talking, that's pretty remarkable. So stuff does change, but it just takes what in human terms are, you know, our lifetimes, maybe 2 or 3 lifetimes. So that's no excuse for inactivity. I want to do speak to that one point that you did make, though, and that is that the stuff is there in the film, the language is there in the film, but some of it is not very palatable. Like when Sam Cooper talks about how 90% of the condos that are built in Vancouver are bought by investors, and then you see the footage where at nighttime, where all of these places are not lit up, I don't know how much clearer I could make it. There's nobody living in those houses. I mean, you go down to Stanley Park and look at the towers around the park, you'll see 8 floors where there's no one there. Now, those aren't just people from offshore. You know, we were talking to a realtor when we were doing research for this, and he was complaining about the Chinese. Oh, the Chinese this, the Chinese that. And then he said, oh yeah, and they're in West Van, they're building this new condominium development, and I think I'm gonna pick up a couple of units in that, just on spec. And I'm just like, did you hear what you just said? You're not Chinese, like, come on. Anyway, somebody else had a comment. Yes, ma'am.
Just like to say, it's a really beautifully done film.
Thank you.
I like all the research that went into it, the actual speakers, the diverse inputs. And I also like the fact that, like, I'm gonna wing sort of romantic, philosophical, but the music, like, you start off with the drums, and then the violins, and then the piano, and it all sort of talks to that undercurrent of how sound travels and how waves of time pass. And it all comes together with, you know, we're living here. This is our home, and it's changing before our eyes. Just like the tide that comes in and goes out, and the man that's in his van is going down to Mexico, and the fact that people invested in China, and that's where, you know, Canadians invested in China and built those factories there, and look what happened to China, and now those people, some of those people have. It's just economic. It's all economic. But you did a really lovely job of presenting it.
Thank you.
And I'm glad to hear that you've covered a lot.
Thanks so much for saying that about the music, because Tina, my wife, was here, who's the producer of the movie. Where are you, Tina? Instead, just wave, okay? Tina, this is one to me. She knows that the only reason that I work on movies is so I get to do music. Because I grew up playing, I was the small half of a two-brother team, and we sang and we were cowboys and we were on television and recorded stuff, but the big half of that team is sitting right there. He's visiting for Thanksgiving. That's my brother, Will. Oh, Sophia. Yes, what were you going to say, dear?
Yeah. Right now, Rain, because I'm on rent with my son, and we're having time, so what I'm going to do, instead of renting him a place to stay, I'm going to get a van for him. He's going to live in a van because of not enough housing situations and the discriminations we still have to endure in this lifetime. And it's not fair because we have to pass that discrimination on to our families. And I don't like to say to my family, gee, you know, those certain people don't like us, you know, and they said, why? But, you know, it's just hard for me to apprehend to this day that I still have to endure that discrimination with jobs, with housing, with even going into the supermarkets to even buy groceries. We get followed around. So what I do end up doing now is when I'm packing the grocery cart around, I hand it to the person and say, now you can follow me around. He's helpful. I have to endure. I really don't mind it now too much. I mean, because I'm in my 70s and I've been there and done that. I just feel sorry for the next generation that still have to endure the discrimination. And the only way we can help with that discrimination is by talking about it within our own families and not say, oh, don't go near that person because they trust differently. Or don't listen to them because they talk differently. Or I can't understand you because you're not from here. I am from here. You know, we're all from here. You're all on our God-given earth. And we all have to learn how to take care of it. And by taking care of it is by taking care of our own. We have to take care of our own. Human beings are our own. We're all human. And we all have to look at each other and put out your hand and say, I can help you. I can help you. It's not that hard, you know. You just have to give your heart when you give things. And it would be so great if we can have proper housing for natives here and not have to get kicked out all the time. That's all I can say.
Thank you. Thank you so much for saying that. That really resonates. You know that we know each other, and I tend to be a pretty optimistic person. I always try and see the bright side of things. And I know that over time, there was no way you could see the bright side of things in the area that you're talking about, because it's been horrible. It's just been awful. I like to think now that with the Truth and Reconciliation process that's getting paid more attention to, and that so many of us really believe passionately is well past due, that things will change, that things will get better within our lifetimes. And I know that many of us are fighting for that. You are. You're just such a cultural warrior, and we do a tiny little bit as well. So I'm hopeful that things will get a little bit better in that regard, because it's true. I mean, the situation here is it's apartheid.
It is, thank you.
Anybody want to follow that?
Yeah.
No, come on, let's do something positive. Yes.
I've only been off the streets
We made a film a number of years ago called Down Here that some of you might have seen. It's a film about the downtown east side, and we took a very much different approach to it than most films about that subject take. Rather than becoming an insider and agitating for the people there, I mean, I've lived in the downtown east side, but I don't consider myself an insider by any stretch of the imagination. I took the point of view of an outsider, somebody who walks or drives through the neighborhood and goes, gee, I wonder what it's like to live down here. And so the point of it was to be able to speak to the hundreds of thousands of people who drive through the neighborhood and see the chaos that's there and just kind of idly wonder, you know, what it's like. We spoke to, I believe, 8 different residents. Most of them were homeless. There were, you know, prostitutes. Everybody had addiction problems. A number of them were First Nations. And we handled it much differently than it's normally handled. Normally, when you film down there, you grab somebody and you film them on the street. There's buses going by and sirens, and it's so undignified. And nobody interviews Robert De Niro like that. Nobody interviews, you know, Justin Trudeau like that. They give them the dignity of a quiet, safe environment where you can actually hear them, and you have the time to develop some kind of a rapport and hear and understand, just listen to what they have to say. So that's what we tried to do. And the effect in the film is quite remarkable. You can watch it online, it's on Knowledge as well, it's called Down Here. But the effect is quite remarkable that you get the sense of the humanity of the people that we talk to. And at first you start feeling pity, you feel like so sorry for them, but as the story goes on, you start to admire the people in the story and realize what incredible strength and ability that they have, and they're but for fortune. And the main thing that I learned from that, and it's a lesson that I carry to this very day, is that when I'm on the street, which I frequently am, the people that speak to you, the people that ask you for money, or the people that ask you for help, are just mostly what they're after is acknowledgement. It's so lonely. You know, people want you to stop and talk, and I do now. I say, how you doing? How about those Canucks? You know, it's that conversation. I mean, it also doesn't hurt to give money because people don't have any money. But the respect of just a fellow human being, I think if that's something we could all take away from this, it would be a good thing. There's nothing to be afraid of. I've never been accosted on the street here. And I know I have friends, young women who are much smaller than I have. They've never been accosted either on the downtown east side. It's not a scary place. It's a place where there are people who live, and it's a good community in many respects. People look after each other. But just take the time to stop and say hello. I think that's an important thing, because they're, like Safina said, they're all human, right?
For
Jordan,
I just wanted to wonder if
I just want to say thank you for sharing, and thank you for sharing. Yeah, I've been really, I guess, the best part of being involved in this process is that I've been honored to hear people's stories a lot over the past couple of years, and more than anything, that has been kind of the motivating factor to do all this. So to hear your story is really a blessing to me, because it keeps me pushing. Thank you.
And at this point, I'd just like to give a huge note of gratitude to Charles and Samantha for really enriching the experience of the film screening tonight as well. And I know for myself, you know, certainly a couple of things that I was left with was the gentleman in the van who said, where are we going to be in 10 years, which isn't far away. And I think it's leaving each and every one of us something to think about. And as well as it, there doesn't, it's certainly complex, but I don't think we need to get overwhelmed by it. And I think that came out beautifully in the film as well, that there's no one easy option. It's not just densification, but there's many, many options, and depending on individual needs as well. And that was brought out beautifully in the film, I think, as well. So thank you again, and it's been a wonderful evening, and thanks everyone for coming out. If you do have some time to, if you've got some comments or feedback on tonight's program, if you'd like to see more of this type of event, please let us know. We have some feedback forms just over in the corner here. And again, thanks for taking some time out. Thanks to Charles. Thanks to Samantha.